الحمد لله رب العالمين، الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. My dear elders and brothers, respected ulama ikram, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. The topic that I have been given today is a topic that is not only essential for all of us to think about, but it's a topic which is really the essence of being a Muslim. It's something about which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala actually asked us the question in the Quran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, أليس الله بكاف عبده. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, is Allah not sufficient for his slave? أليس الله بكاف عبده. Is Allah not enough for you and me? Is Allah not sufficient for his slave? And it's a question we need to ask ourselves. Because in another place Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهَ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا وَيَرْزُقُوا مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَهْتَسِبُ وَمَنْ يَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ فَهُوَ حَسْبُهُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, the one who has taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will extract him from every difficulty. Allah will find a way out for him from every difficulty. وَيَرْزُقُوا مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَهْتَسِبُ. Allah said, and he will provide for him from sources that he could not even imagine. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَمَنْ يَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ فَهُوَ حَسْبُهُ. The one who has tawakkul on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will become sufficient for him. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to become sufficient for us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is sufficient for us. The one who has Allah does not need anybody else. But having Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is an issue of understanding that you have Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's a realization that we have Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To give you an example, if you have a credit card in your pocket, I'm not advocating for you to go and get credit cards, I'm just giving you an example. If you have a credit card in your pocket, and this credit card has an unlimited, there's no spending limit on it. You can spend whatever you want. You want to go and buy a Mercedes, you can use that credit card. It's like that, you know, you can spend $1 million on it if you like. But this credit card is in your pocket and you don't realize that this credit card is in your pocket. And now when you are feeling hungry, and you are very hungry and you want to get some food to eat, and you go to your friend and say, Brother Radha, can you come with me to the shop? You know, I want something to eat and please come and help me. Buy me a meal. Now what's he going to tell me? He will tell you, what is this thing? You are asking me to help you to buy a meal, and you have in your card this card in your pocket, a card where you can buy the whole hotel, the whole restaurant, you can buy the thing if you want. You want me to help you buy a meal? What is this? But why am I asking him to help me to buy a meal? Because I don't realize the value of the card. I don't know what this card can do. Ta'ala Allahul Amsal. We do not give a misal of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The misal we give only is for us to understand. If it's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٌ وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ. Allah said, is not comparable to anything in creation. But we give examples to illustrate. So who? Allah said, وَمَنْ يَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ فَهُوَ حَسْبُهُ. The one who has tawakkul on Allah, Allah is sufficient for him. But who can have tawakkul on Allah? Only the one who understands who is Allah. The only one who can have tawakkul on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who understands the glory and majesty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let me give you another example. If your son is in the market looking for a job, he's just completed his graduation or whatever it is, become an engineer or something, and he is looking for a job. And he gets a job, he gets two job offers. One job offer he gets from a small engineering workshop down the road from where you live. And another job offer he gets from General Electric, the major American multinational company. Listen to the example well. He is getting one job offer from a small engineering workshop. Maybe your friend owns it or something. So he says, Swana, your son is graduated. Fine, ask him to come. I will give him a job. And simultaneously, your son also gets a job offer with General Electric, which is, as you know, is the largest engineering company in the world, big global multinational from America. And both the jobs are paying exactly the same salary. I want you to listen to the example carefully. Both the jobs, your friend's workshop and GE, are paying exactly the same salary. There is not one rupee more. What will you advise your son? Where will you ask him to join? The small engineering shop or GE? Tell me. What do you think? GE. Why? Because the azimuth of GE is in your heart. Say, go work for a big company. You also know, I also know that the chances of getting fired are much higher in GE than in your friend's shop. In your friend's job, your son is probably going to have a special position because he's your son. It's a small workshop. If he does a little bit of good, the owner will immediately come to know. So his lifespan in that business is more secure and more solid. Whereas in a huge, big multinational corporation, one entry-level engineer is like a blade of grass. You know what I mean? Who is he? Probably even his hiring manager has not seen him, because usually the interviews are telephonic. The hiring manager is sitting in New York somewhere, he's hiring him on the phone. His hiring manager also wouldn't have seen him. Despite that, he will say, join that company because it's a big name. That name will look good on your CV. Yes or no? The question to myself and the question to you is, how good does Allah's name look on our CV? How aware are we that we just finished a salah where we said Allahu Akbar and where we made sajda, about which Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that when the Muslim makes sujood, he does not make sajda on the earth, he makes sajda at the feet of Ar-Rahman on his arsh. But the issue is, when we made that sajda, was this hadith in our mind? Were we aware? When we were making the sajda, were we aware that I am making sujood here, but this sajda is being recorded above the seven heavens? Were we aware? When we recite the Quran, when we read the Quran every day, and I hope we all read the Quran every day. If we do not read the Quran every day, we should read the Quran every day. Why? Why must we read the Quran every day? Because of the beautiful hadith of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where he said that when the slave recites the Quran every day, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala waits. Hey, just think about this. Ajib. The position of the believer. My brother, understand who you are. Understand who you are. You're not ordinary people. Understand who you are. The position of the Muslim, the position of the believer is something else. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Allah waits. And then, when the recitation starts, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala draws the attention of those around him. Hey, who is around Allah? The Muqarrabeen of the Malaika, Jibreel and Mikael and Israfil. Allah draws their attention and tells them, listen, listen. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes the name of the slave. Hey. And Allah mentioned this in the Quran, in Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah said, Fazkuruni. What is after that? Azkurkum. فاذكروني أذكركم.
You remember me, I will remember you. You mention me, I will mention you. Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, and this is the hadith of Qudsi where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, when my slave remembers me in a gathering, I remember him in a gathering better than his. What is the meaning of that? It means that understand this and realize this, that as we are sitting here in this masjid in Sri Lanka, each one of us by name is being mentioned on the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. By Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As we are sitting here and we are remembering our Rabb is remembering us by name. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the gatherings for the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for His remembrance. He said there are angels whose only job is to roam the earth and look for gatherings such as this, and may Allah count this gathering among those. And when they find a gathering in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is being mentioned, those angels come and they call others like them and they fill the space and they pile up over one another until they reach the first heaven. There are things that we can see and there are things that we cannot see. And among the things we cannot see are the malaika who are sitting here. There are malaika sitting here. Between the two of you there are angels. Between me and you there are angels. Around me there are angels. Around you there are angels. Over our head there are angels until the seventh, until the first heaven. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that when the gathering is over, these malaika go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they go to the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who knows everything, asks them a question, and the reason Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asks the question is to establish the argument in our favor, is to create witnesses for us on the day of judgment. Allah will ask them, where did you come from? And they will say, we came from this masjid in Colombo. And Allah will say, what were they doing? They will say, your slaves were remembering you, Ya Rab. And Allah will say, what did they want? And the angels will say that they wanted your Jannah. And Allah will say, have they seen my Jannah? And the angels will say, Ya Rabbal Alameen, they have not seen your Jannah. So Allah says, if they see my Jannah, what will happen? The angels will say, Ya Rabbal Alameen, they will want it even more. Then Allah will say, then what else did they want? And the angels will say, Ya Rabbal Alameen, they wanted to be protected from your fire. They wanted to your protection and they were seeking your protection from your adab. Allah asked them, have they seen the Jahannam? Have they seen my fire? And they say, Ya Rabbal Alameen, they have not seen it. Allah says, what will happen if they see it? Say, Ya Rabbal Alameen, they will want your protection even more. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in all His mercy and in all His grace, Allah says, you be witness on the day of judgment, that I will give them that which they were seeking, and I will grant them protection from that which they wanted protection from. Subhanallah. Subhanallah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to include all of us who will be mentioned on the day of judgment, inshallah. And then the angel will say, Ya Rabbal Alameen, but there was a man who was walking by and he just stopped there for a little while. He saw some people sitting there, so he was curious, so he just was walking by. He didn't come with the intention of joining that majlis. He was walking by and he stopped there for a while. What is the hukum for him? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, he is also with them. Because anyone who comes into such a majlis will not be mahroom, will not be deprived of the blessing of that majlis. Are we aware? Alaysa Allahu bikafin abda. Are we aware of who Allah is? And are we aware of our connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Because if we are not aware, my brothers, then we cannot get the benefit of that connection. That awareness is essential.